Professor Wadia and other distinguished members in the audience. It is something of an apprehension with which I give this talk because at least in some part of what I will talk about, Professor Mohan Apte in fact is a far bigger expert than I can ever imagine ever to be, and therefore that part of my discussion on history of astronomy, I'm not going to keep it down because I'm sure otherwise he will have a lot of reasons to scold me. He has also brought out this beautiful book on Aryabhatta, in case you were interested in Aryabhatta period and his work. There's a beautiful piece of work because it has original shlokas, its translations, and the algebraic problem solved in modern methods as we teach them in schools today. So I'm not going to talk much about the Aryabhatta and post-Aryabhatta historic period. What I'm going to try and talk about today is about the origin and growth of astronomy in India. And my interest is essentially on a much older time period. And that is for a variety of reasons. The first question to ask is, why do you really want to bother about history when, I mean, I've spent a lifetime doing more modern science. And the reason for that is that at the end of the day, we are all we are because the way our ancestors were what they were. It is because of the way they solved their problems of life and survival and the way they developed their beliefs and prejudices that we carry ourselves today. And for example, even today, when you talk about Indian students in foreign universities, the general belief is that if you have a problem which requires a lot of thinking and mental work, then you better take an Indian student. If it requires a lot of hard physical labor, take a Chinese student, because a Chinese student will do physical labor much better than an Indian student will. On the other hand, if it requires some profound amount of thinking, stay with an Indian student. And that is because of the way we've been brought up all of our lives. So eventually who we are cannot really be understood unless we know where we came from in every sense of the word. So that's one reason why you want to know history. One way of knowing history, of course, is to go through archaeology, look at all the evidences in archaeology and things like that, and to read texts directly as they are with their meanings and all that. But there's something more subtle that you can do, and that is what I'm going to talk about today. At the end of the day, archaeology will only tell you about technological sophistication. If, for example, the world had been destroyed in Second World War, we would never have known, there was no record to show that we would have known relativity, for example, except unless you could read the books. If all the books were destroyed at the end of Second World War, relativity would not have been known. Today, of course, we have geostationary satellites which we use relativity and things like that. But otherwise, technological sophistication can only tell you so much about a civilization and can't really give you all the depth and details. Intellectual growth, on the other hand, is a far more complex entity. It shows up in a variety of ways. It shows up in myths, religion, literature, astronomy and mathematics, and so on and so forth. So that is a completely different window to human growth. Myths and their association with heaven have been a very long story, a very old story. Right from the beginning, people, it takes very little to realize that the rain comes from the skies, and when the rains come, you get all the food in the food that you want all around you. All the growth happens when there are rains from the sky. So very early, Mother Earth becomes mother and the father becomes sky, and the father sky seeds the earth through rains. And this interlocking relations has been an original among the first myths in all major civilizations, that all major or even minor civilizations that you can think of. All of them begin with this story, and some of the oldest images of mother goddess kind of images are as old as 30,000 years old, which is remarkable. The beautiful wooden and ivory carved pieces of a feminine figurine, essentially an only feminine figurine seen in several civilizations across the world. So this mother and earth and father sky is an image that comes up very early in civilization. Then of course sky does much more than simply give you rain. It gives you thunderbolt, storm, moon, sun, eclipses, rainbows, so on and so forth. It's a very fascinating place to look at, and all these fascinations begin to catch people. Sky of course has this nice pattern of constellations which remains constant. There's a degree of stability. Every day you can see some, at least for 6 months a year, you can see a constellation. It has a fixed pattern, does not change over centuries or millennia, and therefore there is a degree of stability. On the other hand, things like thunderbolt and storms are sudden spurts. So there are time variations of all kinds that you can see in the sky, and all these things are sort of studied, and stars therefore get a very familiar name. So by looking at how a civilization named its stars or constellations, you can actually determine when the civilization actually decided to name the sky or actually noticed the sky in all its depth. Myths and cosmos are closely related. This is an image of a cave painting in South India, where you can see this is the original drawing, and since it can't be seen very clearly, there's a pencil drawing of the same. And you can see that there's an idea over here of a human being lying down. It's a burial chamber of a burial human, of human. There seems to be some idea about the way that light changes. The rays come in one way or the other. There is this flowing stone. There seems to be some kind of an idea about life, death, and associated astronomy. Individual panels, of course, you can interpret, reinterpret. We will never know what the real reason was. But there is clearly some sense of association of cosmos and humans right from very early period. Myths and astronomy are particularly closely related because of the mother and father sky, for mother earth and father sky. And when we talk about astronomy, we'll keep seeing how these interrelations seem to reveal a lot of interesting information. Evolution of astronomy itself, of course, is a fairly complex affair. It doesn't happen easily. In India particularly, there are some interesting features. In all other parts of the world, the original pagan religions which the civilizations must have begun have all been fundamentally replaced by other religions. The Stonehenge, for example, the British have completely replaced their original religions. The Europe essentially was completely, all the Greek religion and everything was cleaned up. When Christianity came in, the West Asian religions were wiped off. When Islam came in, it is in India that we have had this very peculiar continuity between the old and new religion. They still fundamentally change. The religion that we worship today, for example, is very fundamentally different from the way Vedic religion was set up. But even then, there is still a broad continuity and there's a broad acceptance which allows you to go back and map much further back into past than you would be possible to do in other civilizations. This has also produced a rather complicated religion that we have today, which is almost impossible to keep track of. And there are actually discussions about who invented Hinduism, and the general consensus is that actually it's a British invention, and that the religion in India is rather difficult to put into a single box or a single religious complexity because of the various complications that come in about ideas. And I'll show you some of the ideas and myths and how astronomy has interplayed with them. But before I start on that, I want to go through some basic ideas of astronomy that must have ruled the world. We all know that the earth goes around the sun, and because of the tilt of the earth, you get in March you get spring, in September you get autumn, in December you get winter, and in June you get summer, and the earth goes round and round, and this round happens all the time. Then because of this, you can look at the earth, it's, from earth point of view, you can see and feel as if the sun is going up and down over the period of 1 year, and as it goes up and down over a period of year, you get a lot less sunlight when you're here, when the sun is here, a lot more sunlight when you're at the other place. And therefore, from the ground, if you look at, you essentially get west over here, north over here. You can see that in summer, the sun remains in the sky much longer. In winter, the sun remains in the sky much lesser, and therefore you get not enough sunlight, and you get winter, you get summers, and at other time. And this movement is crucial because this movement can be tracked. The point of sunrise of the sun over a period of 1 year can be tracked because the sun doesn't always rise exactly in the east and doesn't set exactly in the west. In fact, it only twice a year does it rise exactly in the east and set exactly in the west. Otherwise, it generally rises somewhere in the east and sets somewhere in the west, and where exactly it rises will tell you what kind of season we have. Then the next major feature is the moon. The moon looms large on the sky. We all know that moon has a 29 and a half day period by which it goes from full moon or new moon to new moon, and it provides a rather magnificent background to the sky. And then moon, of course, goes through its full moon phase, quarter moon phase, two quarter phases, one full moon, one new moon phase, as the sun goes round and round, and it takes about 29 and a half days to complete this circle. So these are some of the basic astronomical observations that anybody would make within a few years of rise of consciousness, if you wish. If you are more systematic, over a period of 1 year, for example, you would notice that the sunrise point changes into different constellation, the sun rises in different constellation over a period of 1 year, and this cycle also goes on annually and fairly regularly. Then you have eclipses, which are not so easy, they don't come very frequently, they seem to have a very peculiar period, the period is 18 and a half years, and you get the eclipse again every 18 and a half years, but it really looks spectacular. It's not so easy to get a handle about how eclipses are born. Then you have planets, the nine objects that move in the sky, seven objects that move in the sky, others don't, but these five planets and moon and sun, the five moving objects in the night sky, Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, and sun and moon, give you also the days of the week, but these five wanderers are also noticed. Then you have comets occasionally randomly coming in. And the last and probably the most interesting feature is the fact that the Earth precesses. Because the Earth has this 23.5 degree tilt, that tilt does not remain at a constant place. It points to different stars in the night sky over a period of 14,000 year period. It goes in 28,000 year period. So for example, today we call Dhruva Tara or the pole star as our Polaris as our pole star. 3000 BC Thuban was our pole star. 14,000 years ago Vega was our pole star. And in a few hundred years, we actually won't have a pole star because there is no other major star in the path along which the Earth's axis moves. And therefore, if you observe for several hundred years, you will notice that the star in the pole actually changes. That also means that the way the sun rises changes. What you have here is the Earth's sky axis. You have various constellations in the sky. And in 10,000 BC, for example, if you look at the day of equal day and equal night, the sun would have risen very close to the Leo constellation. Today, 6,000 years ago, it rose very close to Gemini constellation. Today, of course, it rises very close to Pisces or Perseus. So the location at which the sun rises on the day of equal day, length of day and night, essentially changes over a period of thousands of years. And this has also been noticed in all literatures over a period of time. Similarly, of course, solstices are also rise and solstice point also keeps changing in the night sky. Okay. So that is essentially the only amount of astronomy that we knew until 16th or 17th century AD. Okay, that's when Galileo came and Newton came and telescopes came and a whole bunch of things came. Till then, this was the astronomical knowledge we had. But acquiring this much knowledge is also not easy because it requires enormous expenditure of time, resources, technology and intellect in order to produce the comprehensive picture that you want to produce. And cultures therefore require to mature to various levels of understanding and capabilities in order to be able to extract so much knowledge about astronomy. There are basically four stages in which you can define this. The first stage is the initial step, when people realize that there is something called the sky and something interesting happens in the sky. The second level is the level at which you start tracking seasons, keep track of astronomy far more closely, and you have some interesting astronomy of settlements. And I'm going to talk about each of these phases in detail as the time goes. The third level is the astronomy of civilizations, when, for example, astrology and speculation about human place of human beings in the affairs of the universe, etc., and various speculations about who we are, why we are, etc., comes in. And that goes under the broad name of cosmogony, where we try to understand our role with relation to the cosmos. Then fourth, or the most modern base, is this technology-based astronomy, which has its own complexities, its own achievements, but it is fundamentally different from the other three phases of astronomy. And if you give me a civilization, or if you tell me that these people knew so much history, I would be able to place them as to where they are within this map, and therefore you can get a pretty good map about the intellectual growth of a civilization by knowing its astronomy. So it works both ways. If you know the civilization, you would know how much astronomy they knew. If you know how much astronomy they know, you can guess what their general intellectual growth must have been. So let me begin with the first stage astronomy. You're talking about people who are essentially hunter-gatherers, who have just about become aware of their environment, who have some idea about the skies, and have sort of been looking at it at night, but essentially living a rather simple life. At this stage, they would certainly realize that the sun is a place of warmth and all the life and light. If there is no sun in the sky, there is essentially no light. They would also realize that the rains come, the sun is there, and the sun, sky and rains are identified as crucial life givers. You know that you need water and rain for life to come. You know that sky, by sending in water, rejuvenates the earth like nothing else can. And this becomes an everlasting image in human life. And in fact, even the earlier generation of Homo sapiens, we are Homo sapiens, but the earlier group called Neanderthals, also we suspect, had some idea about these things, because if you look at their burials of Neanderthals, you can see that there is some sense of feel about the environment. It also becomes, because of its elegance and importance, people very quickly start putting their gods in the skies, in the heavens, and that continues even till today. Then arrival of the first art. It's quite interesting that the first human art actually begins at this stage, because rock art comes at this stage. And from rock art, you can make a lot more astronomical, get an idea about astronomical knowledge of these people than you would imagine. Settling down brings the first generation astronomy, where they start identifying seasons with sunrise points and so on and so forth. This is a picture from a French cave 30,000 years ago, and you can see that behind this bull, there are three very clear astronomical notings of Orion, Taurus and Pleiades, and in the sky also, they are placed exactly as they are shown in the drawing, and this drawing, like I said, goes back to about 30,000 years ago. We have some interesting undated paintings from India. This is a painting from Chillas in Kashmir, where you have this idea of the sun god and the seasons, and the sun god riding the chariot of a chariot, and therefore traveling through the night sky, an image that would subsequently become very formal in India. There's an interesting rock art that has fascinated us for a long time. If you look at it a priori, then there is a hunter over here, there is a hunted deer over here, there is a hunted, there is a person apparently helping the hunt, and there are two skies in the night sky and a dog. And we have for a long time wondered as to how you can have two skies, two stars and two suns in the night sky, and if the moon and the sun are so close to each other, the moon essentially would be in its last phases going to new moon, so it would never be this bright. So the question that we wanted to ask is whether there is something more profound in this. And then because this Taurus looks like a sky object in the sky, this looks like another very known, well-known constellation of Orion, Taurus and Andromeda. We plotted it in the night sky, and then we get an interesting association. If you plot this is a very major constellation in the sky, and if you plot this bull over there, then this human figure straight away fits into this other figure over here. So you get this Taurus with its head and everything. You get this Orion, the man who is a hunter with his bow and arrow and everything. And you get the dog over here. And all these three are very conspicuous constellations. And the sun, of course, moves along this line. So you would expect sun anywhere in the sky at various times. But the interesting thing that comes out is that about 5000 BC, there's a supernova over here which has gone off, and which was as bright as the moon sunlight during daytime when it went off 5000 years ago. So our suspicion is that this rock art that you're talking about is probably the earliest recorded human record of an unusual sky object about 5000 years. It was 5000 years ago, it was 3000 BC when the supernova came off. So there are interesting tantalizing suggestions that people have taken skies very seriously right from the beginning. This is another very lasting image. It comes, of course, from Kashmir again in an area called Rikse. But this image is very common in several cave paintings across the world of people who had never sort of communicated with each other. But this idea of a superhuman controlling the sun and the moon is something that has been a very old and lasting image. The idea that there was some kind of a super god who controlled everything that happens in the night sky. The second stage astronomy, and this is a picture again from a site called Burzam in Kashmir, where you have this kind of standing rocks and you can suggest it is probably astronomical. You are talking about people with this kind of lifestyles, settled permanent housing made of thatching, surviving on hunting and on farming and so on and so forth. At this stage, then they would start creating more interesting astronomy. Now they would start seriously thinking about astronomy. They would create huge megalithic stone structures of the Stonehenge kind. They would look at various aspects of the sky and study it very seriously. At this stage, we suspect that they start defining patterns in the night sky defining constellations, zodiacs, and nakshatras and things like that. Nakshatras are unique to India. Zodiacs and constellations are seen everywhere. Nakshatras, which are essentially the regions in which the moon moves, is an Indian invention. Ecliptic eclipses get noticed and attempts get made to determine their eclipses. For example, in Stonehenge in 5,000 years ago, they were trying to predict eclipses using movement of stones. Transient events like comets get recorded, and there's a fairly large recording of number of comets and classification in this age. New myths are created to explain these observations, and first serious speculations about who we are and what is our place in the universe starts coming up in the literature. Megaliths are incidentally very large structures created to study the sunrise and sunset patterns, and they become essential for calendrical purposes. Megalithic structures are gigantic in size, and I'll show you how big they can be. In the Western context, we have clear studies which show that they were essentially for astronomical use. In India, for example, in South India itself, there are something like 2,000 megaliths, which about whose origin we don't know. We suspect that they are astronomical in origin, and I'll show you a couple of interesting examples of that kind. But we really haven't studied our megaliths at all. This is an example from Hanam Sagar, where something like 2,500 stones have been put in almost exactly north-south direction. Some of these are disturbed because of the farming and other issues, but because about 20 years ago the government gave this land for farming, so some of these stones have been disturbed, but you can still see large-scale patterns of stone arrangements for reasons that we don't even understand. We have no idea. More interestingly is the site in Baise. It's a place near Mangalore where we know there was a prehistoric existence because there are mounds of human waste products as well as burial sites and so on and so forth. This site has been studied very well, but there's an interesting collection of stones which have so far not been studied, or until recently were not studied. You can't really make out much from there, so let me show you the details. This is, for example, huge stones. I mean, some of the stones in this place are huge. This is called Bhutaraya stone, which is good 2.5 to 3 meters tall. There's another half a meter stone which is essentially broken. You can see the second half lying there. So these are huge stones, and these stones did not certainly come at random from there. They were just not randomly there. They have been conscientiously and carefully brought over there. If you go and look at the pattern, and this is what the pattern looks like, you will essentially see nothing. You will essentially think that it's a random collection of stones put together somewhere for reasons that we don't know, and you would essentially move on to other things in life, until of course a student of mine, Sri Kumar Menon, went and plotted how the shadows of these stones play out during winter solstice sunrise. And you find that in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 cases, the shadow of one stone falls on the other stone. In other words, somebody has actually gone to this place, taken a stone here, and when the equinox sunrise comes, gone and arranged the second stone in such a way, the shadow from one falls on the other. And there are 10 such coincidences, which is far more than what you would expect by chance, clearly suggesting that somebody was using even a random pattern like this for some serious astronomical tracking. And this would date to at least a couple of thousand years BC, or about 5,000 years, 4,500 years ago or so. Then there is another stone structure near Mangalore. Again, you can see one stone over here, there's another stone here, third stone there. And if you look at these stones, for example, they tend to be this particular stone is more than a couple of meters high, and it is just 2.5 inches, or about 5 centimeters thick, and the whole thing has been put into the ground and made to stand vertically. If you look at this stone itself is a meter in size, a couple of meters in size, and if you look at the winter solstice sunset, you can see that it passes right through between this stone and this stone, and we really don't know why this has been done. Our suspicion is that this is also an astronomical observatory of 1000 BC or so. In this context, I just want to briefly look at what religion at that time looked like. Vedic religion roughly has about 30 gods, depending on how you classify them. 5 are human like. Indra is there, Ribhus is there, Vishnu is there, Yama is there, and Manu is there. There are 15 that refer to various natural forces like Agni and Soma. There are 4 that refer to water. Interestingly, monsoon, the rains, is called Parajanya, born to somebody else. And that is a name for monsoon even in Rigvedic literature. They probably had some idea that rains are a result of something completely different. There are eight that overlap with Avastha in Iran: Indra, Mitra, Agni, Soma, Vayu, Apasa, and Dyahu. Prithvi connection come from Avastha. And then the Trimurti, who would eventually dominate Hindu religion, are actually only weakly mentioned in this early literature. Shiva is essentially still in his Rudra form. Vishnu is just a benevolent entity. And Brahma, in fact, is the guru of the gods. Only subsequently they become central. And subsequently Indra, who was central to Vedic literature, actually loses his identity, if you wish. There are some notable omissions in this. There is no moon, there are no stars, and there are no planets. There is no real feminine form of worship. Okay, only Aditi is there, who gives birth to the Adityas. And if you wish, Prithvi is a feminine form. Otherwise, essentially, it's a male form. So it's a religion that has already gone through this mother earth, father earth, sky concept to way beyond into a classically male-dominated religion where all the gods are essentially male. Also, the religion itself is a tripartite relation between gods, ancestors, and humans, and each has to make sure that the other one gets what he wants so that the god gives you what you want in turn. And it's an interesting triangular relation. We don't follow it, most of it, except if you ever have done this Shraddha ceremony at the death of a relative, you will know that almost the entire ceremony is Vedic in its structure. You essentially go and sort of give your homage to your ancestors seven generations back and things like that. That is the only time we really follow the original remnant of the religion. Now, of course, what we follow with idol worship is completely different from that. On the other hand, even though it does not worship astronomy, Rigveda considers astronomy very seriously, and it says just as the comb of a peacock and the crest jewels of a serpent, so the Jyotisha is the head of auxiliaries of Vedas. Astronomy is the most important of auxiliary knowledge of Vedas, and there are lots of interesting ideas in the Vedic literature. Okay, both Rigveda and Yajurveda have their own aspects of astronomy and have Vedang Jyotisha of their own, in which there are interesting calculations. They are accurate to the extent of defining the duration of the year and division of the day, year into seasons, how which season will last for how many days and things like that. They are aware of the discrepancies between lunar and solar month, and they realize that you need to add a month every 2.5 years in order to, say, resynchronize the solar and lunar calendar. And therefore, they have this concept of Adhik Masa, which comes right from early Vedic period, where they add 2 months.